Welcome to the practical teaching of Joyce Meyer. We believe you will enjoy this teaching entitled, A Sanctified and a Circumcised Ear.
Oh, we're starting a brand new series tonight called How to Hear from God. Is there anybody out there that needs to hear from God?
Amen.
Everybody say, I can hear from God.
I can hear from God.
Say, I believe I can hear from God.
I believe I can hear from God.
I will not be deceived.
I will not be deceived.
I know my Father's voice.
I know my Father's voice.
And the voice of a stranger I will not follow.
And the voice of a stranger I will not follow.
Say it one more time. Say, I can hear from God. The title of the message tonight is A Sanctified and a Circumcised Ear. A sanctified and a circumcised ear. Just briefly, the word sanctified means made holy and set apart for God's use. And the word circumcised means to cut back the flesh or to cut off the flesh. One of the things that I've noticed over the years is that a carnal person hears with a carnal ear. A fleshly person hears with a fleshly ear. And you're going to hear a scripture a little bit later in Jeremiah where God told him their ears are not circumcised. You know, you can preach a message to a room full of people and people hear a lot of different things depending on where they're at in their growth. For example, you can take a scripture like, say, 3 John 2, Beloved, I would above all else that you prosper and be in health, even as your soul prospers. A person that's less mature will get all excited about the part about prosperity and healing, and that's pretty much all they'll hear. Wow, praise God, he wants me to prosper and be in health. But a person who's grown a little bit and had a little more experience with the Lord, it's a little further down the road, he'll hear that part about even as your soul prospers. And he gets the message real quick that God's going to give us prosperity and healing in correlation with how we mature and how we grow up and how our soul is prospering. You can listen to a teaching today and hear one thing from it. You can listen to it a year from now and hear something that you didn't even hear before. Because as we grow, we begin to even hear differently. Not only do we think differently, not only do we talk differently and act differently, but we hear differently. So we need to talk tonight, get a foundation laid before we get off into other things about having a sanctified and a circumcised ear. First of all, I need to say to you that divine guidance is God's will for us. And that might sound like a pretty foundational thing to say, but I believe that there's probably people in this room tonight that you're still trying to decide if God really talks to people and how he talks to people. And, you know, is God really involved on a day-to-day basis in running our lives? Does he really want to be involved in all the little tiny details of our life? Or should we only bother God and maybe expect to hear from God with major things that we can't handle? And, you know, I went to church for a lot of years, and I mean, I sincerely loved Jesus. But I didn't know God talked to people. And I mean, I observed all the religious holidays and went to church every Sunday and was really doing all I know to do and knew to do at that time. But nobody ever taught me that God speaks to people. And I think that we have to have that clearly established in our heart, that God wants to guide each one of you, not just preachers. You know, he's not just going to speak to the Billy Grahams and the Oral Roberts and, you know, the people that we look up to and respect. But God wants to speak to you. We can all grow to the point where we don't have to run to somebody else all the time and ask them what we ought to do in every situation. The Bible says that there is an anointing that abides on the inside of each one of us, and that anointing teaches us and will lead us. And it says you have no need to run to somebody else for teaching, and that doesn't mean you don't have to come like this for teaching. It's not talking about the teaching gift that I'm functioning in, but it's talking about that we don't have to run to somebody else all the time to find out what God is saying for our lives. We need and have a right to be confident that we can each one individually be led by the Spirit. Isaiah 42:16. And I will bring the blind by a way that they know not. And I don't think that's talking about somebody physically blind. I think that's talking about those that don't see what they ought to do. You ever feel like when you're in a situation that you're just blind as far as... You ever feel like that, like you're blind and deaf? You know, the Bible talks about the blind and the deaf, and we always take that as those physically blind and deaf, and those promises are for them also, but they're also for people, and I think a lot of times largely for people that are spiritually blind and deaf. Jesus said they have ears to hear and they hear not, they have eyes to see and they see not. He was talking about they may have ears on their head and eyes in their head, but they're not seeing what I'm trying to get across to them, and they're not hearing what I'm saying to them. And I will bring the blind by a way that they know not, and I will lead them in paths that they have not known, and I will make darkness into light. I want you to receive that for your life tonight. If you feel like that you're just stumbling around in the darkness and don't know what to do, please take that promise for yourself tonight. God wants to turn your darkness into light. I will make darkness into light before them, and I will make uneven places into a plain. These things I have determined to do for them, I will not leave them forsaken. Isn't that good news? Wow. Do you know of all the prayer requests that we get into our office, which at this point, how many prayer requests would you say we're getting into our office every week now? A couple of hundred? Hundreds? Val does the mail. She says hundreds. And wouldn't you all agree that probably out of all the things that we get requests for, that more than anything, the largest percentage is people who have problems and they don't know what to do. They just don't know what they ought to do. I need to hear from God. I need to know what I ought to do. I have to make a decision. I don't know what to do. Pray for me that I'll know what to do. Pray for me that I can make a decision. And you know, it's an uncomfortable place to be in. To be in that place of indecision, where you're not making any decision. You know you need to do something, but you just don't know what you ought to do. And then sometimes it's when we're in that place that we start running around to people all the time, asking them what we ought to do. And you know, the Bible says that there's safety in many counselors, and I'm not saying that it's wrong to go to people that maybe you feel are wiser than you and ask them for a word of counsel or a word of advice. But if you take it out of balance, it'll hinder you hearing from God. God's a jealous God. And he doesn't appreciate it if we're always putting people ahead of him and we're always running to people to see what we ought to do. And I think sometimes if we go to people, it ought to be after we already feel that we've got something established in our hearts and we go maybe just as a double check, wanting to just use a little wisdom, make sure that we're right. And I'm sure there's always a few times here and there when we're just absolutely not going to be able to get a breakthrough and you might need to go and ask somebody that you trust and respect for a little word of wisdom. But I really want to encourage you, if you ever want to hear from God, if you have a problem in this area of running to people, you need to start weaning yourself off of that and disciplining yourself to always go to God first and not be running to somebody else all the time to find out what they think that you ought to do. I say this teasingly, but really I mean it. Most people don't even know what they're doing, let alone be qualified to tell you what you ought to do. And I don't mean that insultingly. I just mean that most people have got enough issues in their own life that they're trying to deal with. They're trying to hear from God. But you know, sometimes because we don't want other people to think we don't know, even though we might not know what we're doing, if somebody else comes to us, we'll try real hard to give them an answer, even if we're not sure that it's one from God. So you got to be really, really careful when you go running to other people all the time. Now go to Isaiah 30, verse 21. I mean, there's some great promises in here. And your ears will hear a word behind you saying, this is the way, walk in it. Now see, there's two things there. God's going to tell you the way, and then we have to do the walking. We'll do it by His strength and His grace, but this is the way, walk in it. When you turn to the right hand and when you turn to the left hand. So every time I turn around, God's going to be giving me guidance. Now, you can write these scriptures down. We don't have time to go and look at all these, but 1 Corinthians chapter 2 and John 16, verse 13, tell us that the Holy Spirit knows the secret counsels of God. 1 Corinthians chapter 2 says that Only the spirit of a man within a man knows what's going on in him. Only the spirit within a man knows what's going through that man's mind. And it says, so the Spirit of God is the only one who knows the mind of God. Well, the Holy Spirit's in us. God in heaven has a plan for our lives. You know that? That before you were ever born, God laid out a good plan for your life. A good plan, a good plan, a good plan, a good plan. Not a lousy plan, a good plan. Every person in here, God has already established and laid out a good plan for your life. But you know what I'm convinced, and I don't mean this to sound negative, but I'm convinced that probably more people never really get into the fulfillment of God's plan for their life than those who do. There are probably really very few people who end up walking in the perfect will of God for their life simply because they don't know how to hear from God and how to follow God's instructions. God knew that we needed help, so he sent the Holy Spirit to dwell on the inside of every one of us. Jesus said, it's going to be better for you if I go away, because if I don't go away, the Holy Spirit can't come. Jesus was in a body just like we are, and he can only be one place at a time. But the Holy Spirit can be in every single one of us, everywhere we go, all the time, individually leading and guiding every one of us. Isn't that great? And not only that, you never get away from him. He knows the mind of God for you. But God's got an individual plan for you. It's not necessarily like everybody else you know. God has got an individual plan for you, and the Holy Spirit knows what it is. A combination of 1 Corinthians 2 and John, the book of John, chapter 16, verse 13, it says, the Holy Spirit knows the secret counsels of God, and he guides us into all truth. He guides us into truth for our life. But I wrote this down. It's a little, kind of a little catchy way to say something. Do you know you can come face to face with truth and not face truth? How many times does God show us what to do, but we don't do it? Because we don't like that plan. Have you ever noticed how deaf we can get if we don't like what God said? We can come face to face with truth, but we have to face truth. And you know, facing truth is not an easy thing on our flesh. It's easy to face truth about somebody else, but it's harder to face truth about us. Boy, I tell you, we've got a way that we want it to go, and we've got a way we want it to work out. And most of the time, to be honest with you, and you just can say amen or oh me or whatever you want to, most of the time, we go to God with our plan, and we want him to make it work. Instead of us going to God for his plan, knowing that if we will submit to it, it will always work. Amen. God's ways are perfect. Amen. There is no error in God's ways. So you just kind of tuck that away somewhere and do what you want to with it. Maybe you've been coming face to face with truth, but not facing it. You can write this down, Psalm 48:14. And boy, I like this. I looked this up today. This just cheered my heart. God is our guide even unto death. Wow. If you think about it, you know, if you were going to go out and maybe tour Africa or something and you didn't know how to get through the jungle, you'd probably get a guide. But you'd get a guide to get you from one destination to the next. Well, we've got a guide to get us from one destination to the next too. God is our guide even until we leave this place. He's committed to us to guide us. Now, how much can you know? Can you know everything? Are there going to be times when you just don't know? Are there going to be times when you just feel like that person that can't see, just kind of feeling your way through the darkness? Yes, there will be. You say, is that God's will for me? Yes, sometimes it is. You say, why? Because it's in those times that our faith is stretched and we learn to trust. It doesn't take trust when we have understanding and knowing. And probably you're going to have a mixture of times in your life where at the same time you can be knowing something about one area that you've been seeking God on, and yet there'll be another thing on the horizon that you don't seem to know about. And 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 10 says that we know in part and we prophesy in part. We know in part and we prophesy in part. So I don't think that there's ever going to be a time in my life or yours when we can stand there and say, well, I know everything about everything that I need to know. I've got every answer for my life right now. There's nothing that I need to know. I know it all. Now, some of us have a problem thinking we know it all. No amens? I'll get my sign out. Some of us have a problem thinking we know it all.
Amen.
Don't you like that sign? Isn't that fun? We know in part. How does God lead us? Step by step. Step by step. It's interesting, you know. Chris opened the worship with that song tonight. He didn't even know this was part of my message. How does God lead us and guide us? Step by step. Do you know what? I want you to listen to what I'm getting ready to say. A lot of you think that you're not hearing from God, and you are. And you know why you think you're not hearing from God? You think you're not hearing from God because you don't know the whole plan. You think you're not hearing from God because you don't see everything clearly. But you are hearing from God because you hear from Him step by step. Hearing from God is a progressive deal. Now, I'd like you to go to Genesis chapter 12. I think some of you, by the time you get out of here tonight, you're going to be cheered up that you are hearing from God. And you know, I believe if your faith is stirred up in that area that you can hear from God, you are hearing from God, you have been hearing from God, and you will keep hearing from God, then you're a lot more likely to be open to what God wants to say to you next. Have you ever noticed that the devil likes to lie to us? Genesis chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. Now in Haran, the Lord said to Abram, go for yourself for your own advantage away from your country, from your relatives and your father's house to the land that I will show you. Now, he gave Abraham step one, but he did not give him step two. And he even basically told him there, you're not going to get step two until you've done step one. Folks, please get this. It's so simple, but so profound. Some of you are not understanding what God's trying to say because he's giving you direction one step at a time, but you're refusing to take step one until you think you can understand step two, three, four, and five. And I believe some of you tonight, you're going to see something and you're going to start progressing and going forward in God's plan for your life. It is a step-by-step plan. It is a progression. That's how we hear from God. God spoke to Abram. Do you realize that was a pretty difficult thing? He said to him, Abraham, pack up your tent. Leave this country that you're familiar with. Leave your family. Leave all your relatives. This is for your advantage. Do you know, it might have not felt to him like it was to his advantage at that time. There's no evidence in the Bible that he was having a lot of relative problems. He might have liked them all just fine. But God said, now, pack up your tent and go to the place that I will show you. And you know what? Anytime we obey God, blessings come with it. So many people are not being blessed because they're not obeying. I'm going to say it again. So many people are not being blessed because they're not obeying. God has laid out a good plan for our life that we might walk in it. He shows us, we walk. Every once in a while, he'll be gracious enough to you to drag you part of the way. But there comes a time where the dragging's over and he says, now walk. And not only does God want a body of people that will obey, but he wants a body of people that will obey quickly. The Lord doesn't even want us at that point anymore where he's got to argue with us 3 or 4 weeks to get us to do some simple little thing. Praise the Lord. I've had obedience on my heart all year. And I mean, God just, he spoke that to me at the beginning of the year for my own personal life, for some things that are upcoming. And I know that. But see, so often God gives us that word and we don't do what he said. And then we're grumbling and complaining because the blessings didn't come. Here's the promise. Verse 2, and I will make of you a great nation, and I will bless you with abundant increase of favors, and I will make your name famous and distinguished, and you will be a blessing dispensing good to others. Now, boy, we can read that promise and say, oh, hallelujah, hallelujah, God put that on me. But you can't forget, see, do you understand that what he told the man in verse 1 was a hard thing? It was a sacrifice. Everybody say sacrifice.
Sacrifice.
He said, leave the place where you're at, the place where you're comfortable. Leave this thing that you know, all your relatives, all your family, and just start moving, buddy, in faith to the place that I will show you. Now, do you think that Abram worried about it? No, he did not. Let's go to Hebrews 11. I believe there's somebody in here that you've already gotten the word from God that he sent you here to get. That doesn't mean you get to leave yet, but urged on by faith, Abraham, when he was called, obeyed and went forth to a place which he was destined to receive as an inheritance, and he went, although he did not know or trouble his mind about where he was to go. Isn't that good? He just got out there and started moving in faith. I had that experience when I left my job 7 years ago at Life Christian Center. God gave me that scripture. One night in the middle of the night, I was on my way to Quincy, Illinois to do a meeting up there. And it was dark and I felt lonely. And I had that word from God to pack up my stuff and go. God told me, I'm finished with you here. I'm finished with you here. You know, sometimes God gets finished and we're not finished. He said, I'm finished with you here. Go. Take your ministry. Go north, south, east, and west. Dave and I went out here in this town, and we started trying to rent a place to have our meetings, our weekly meetings. Because there was no north, south, east, and west to go to. I mean, nobody knew us. And I felt like the first thing God told us to do was start a meeting in North St. Louis, South St. Louis, West County, and we did one eventually over in Belleville. So, I mean, I literally obeyed God and just took our ministry and started going north, south, east, and west. We didn't go very far at first, but here's the thing. God said, leave and go to the place that I will show you. We started going around trying to find a place to rent to have our meetings. We could not get anybody to rent to us. Nobody would rent to us. I mean, we begged. We called hotels. We called banquet centers. They said, no, we can't rent to something like that every week. We can't do that. You know, this is a banquet center. We can't do that every week. We just can't do that. And the whole thing was God was not going to give us a breakthrough until we obeyed him in step one. And you know how we are. You know what we normally want to do? We want those new things, boy. We want to reach out and take hold of those new things, but we want to keep hold of this thing back here just in case this one don't work. In case we reach out there and we take hold of that and it doesn't make us happy or it's not what we want, you know, we want to have something to run back to. We want to have something familiar to fall back on. But God don't work like that. He says, if you want my plan for your life, then you get out here in the deep water where if I don't help you, you're going to drown. You want to see God's good plan for your life? Come on out in the deep. It's deep. When you just start step by step obeying God. What if you're wrong? What if I'm wrong? I mean, how many times do you think I said to God, what if I'm wrong? God, I've got a good job here. I've got a good ministry at this church. I had already put 5 years in there. I mean, things were going good. God, what if I'm wrong? If I'm wrong, I'm losing everything that I've spent 5 years working for. And you know the interesting thing? When you're at that place, you have no way in the natural of knowing for sure if you're right or wrong because you haven't yet seen the fruit of that obedience. So you're not human. You're not gonna...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.